for this great privilege that has given to us this hour to advance the course of knowledge. Lift up your voice and give him glory and praise. Magnify his name. Ancient of days, the creator of the heavens and the earth, we give you glory and praise for this singular opportunity that you are giving to us. Father, we thank you. We want to commit this great lecture unto your able hands, for whatever that is committed into his hands, according to your word, he said you shall keep unto a perfect day. Father, you are the source of all knowledge. You are the source of wisdom. You are the source of understanding. You are the source of revelation. Let your spirit move mightily in our midst all through the duration of this lecture, and let your name alone be glorified. Father, we thank you. Father, we give you glory and praise. Be thou exalted, O Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, over to you. Sweet Holy Spirit, over to you. Let it be that at the end of this lecture, everyone partaker would have gone home richly blessed in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you glory and praise. Even the grace required to put to work the knowledge that will be garnered via this lecture, we receive it in the name of Jesus. Be thou exalted, O Lord, for in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Let's give Jesus a big hand.
Thank you, the chaplain. In our standing position, we shall take the national anthem, and then we take the Covenant University anthem. The band. The Covenant University anthem. Thank you. Please, we may be seated. We'd like to, one more time, welcome us to this 43rd public lecture of Covenant University. But before I invite the registrar for the proper welcoming and recognition of members on the high table. We'd like to establish the protocol for this 43rd public lecture. The Chairman, Board of Regents, and our Chancellor, Dr. David Oyedepo, the Vice President, Education of the Living Faith Church Worldwide, Pastor Mrs. Faith Oyedepo, esteemed members of the Board of Regents here present, and the Mandate Secretary, Pastor Yemim Nathaniel, the Vice Chancellor, Covenant University, Professor Charles Ayo, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Taiwo Abioye, the Registrar of Covenant University, Pastor Olamide Olusegun, other principal officers here present, deans of colleges and the School of Postgraduate Studies, the distinguished lecturer for today, Professor Sanjay Misra, distinguished members of the Senate of Covenant University, members of faculty and staff here present, distinguished guests, kings and queens in Hebron, members of the praise, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. At this point, we'd like to invite the registrar to please take on the next assignment. The registrar, Pastor Olamide Olusegun.
Chancellor, sir, permit me to stand on the already established protocol. It is my privilege to welcome every one of us to the 43rd public lecture of Covenant University. It was Baron Buffett that said, "You are in the shade today because someone went through the problem of planting a tree yesterday." We are all living witnesses of the challenges being endured by our nation through the drastic fall in the price of crude oil. However, we are not here today to evaluate the problems, but as it is our tradition in Covenant University, we are here to provide a solution that will not only enable our nation to become self-reliant in the production of software, but also to become a major, a global exporter of world-class software. My studies revealed that this nation spends 1 billion naira annually on the importation of software. While as far back as 2010, our nation had the potential of revenue of $6 billion. Now, I believe that the tree that we are planting today, if well nurtured, will result in annual earnings from local production in excess of $77 billion made from crude oil in the year 2014. Our guest lecturer, Professor Sanjay Misra, distinguished professor, is already seated, and he will be doing justice to the topic of the public lecture. At this junction, please permit me to introduce members of the high table. Dr. Olawande Daramola, Dean, College of Business and Social Studies. Professor Ogbologo is the Dean Center for Leadership Development Studies. Professor Chinedu is the Dean School of Postgraduate Studies. Our amiable Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Taiwo Abioye, and our world-class and award-winning Vice Chancellor, Professor Charles Ayo. Once again, you are welcome.
Can we applaud the Registrar of Covenant University? At this point, we'd like to invite our third substantive Vice Chancellor of Covenant University, Professor Charles Ayo, for his opening remarks. Professor.
You may please be seated. The Chancellor and Chairman Board of Regents of Covenant University, permit me to stand on the already established protocol, but I want to assure you that very soon the Chancellor or his representative will be in our midst. I must not fail to recognize the family of Professor Misra, particularly the young man there that I fondly refer to as the young professor. Please put your hands together for him. Once again, I'm most delighted to welcome you all to this historic occasion, talking about the 43rd public lecture of Covenant University, titled Global Software Development, Challenges and Opportunities in Nigeria, to be delivered by our able and erudite scholar, Professor Misra, whose profile will be given to us as soon as possible. But while waiting for that, permit me to just take you through the future of ICT very briefly. ICT remains one of the most important tools of making businesses competitive now and in the future. ICT has the potential to solve many of our nation's greatest challenges, from global warming, water shortages, and other environmental issues, through to driving increased productivity and opening up access to new markets and opportunities through improved communications. The ICT industry is continually growing and developing. New technologies are emerging, and innovation is possible through these new technologies and the internet. Technologies such as cloud computing, mobile technologies, social media, e-business and e-commerce, 3D imagery and content, brainwave sensing, gaming interfaces and controls for business applications, and virtual worlds collaboration means new opportunities and new ways of working around the world. Permit me to present to you the US News and World Report that presents the statistics regarding 2020 growth figures for some titles in the field of computing. Software application developers expected to gain 143 million jobs by 2020, an increase of 27.6%. System software developers, talking about web developers, won 27,000 jobs, an increment of 32%. Database administrators expected to spike 36% and gain about 34,000 new jobs. Computer and information systems managers will grow from about 308,000 positions to approximately 364,000, an increase of 18%. Good news. I thought you were putting your hands together. You know that in Covenant University we have collaboration with New Horizon Solutions Limited that offers a platform for international ICT certification. And I want to seize this opportunity to enjoin our students to please avail themselves of the available opportunities here for a better and greater future. Permit me to mention at this point also, looking at the number of our certifications that we run in the university, most importantly, talking about product and project managers. According to the Project Management Institute, noted six areas of greatest promise for project practitioners in energy, healthcare, IT, construction, finance, aerospace, and defense. Again, we have a projection for 2020, according to the Project Management Institute, that in Canada, 582,000 and above will be needed by the year 2022. In Brazil, 1.3 million new project managers will be needed. Germany, 1.6. Japan, 2.6. India, 9 million. China, 32 million. And we are simply talking about close to 25 million new project managers by the year 2020. That is just to mention one of the certification programs that we run here. Again, according to the Institute, the mouth-watering salaries in Australia are talking about over $134, even more than what a paid professor, almost double or three times what a professor is paid. Switzerland won over $133,000. Netherlands $103, along the line. As I close, permit me to once again charge our students here what I call digital entrepreneurship. Bright minds do not only translate to innovativeness, but entrepreneurship. According to Eleanor Roosevelt, the future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. Yes, dreams come true if you believe. And I'm sure I have dreamers in their house. Let the dreamers put their hands together. So I therefore wish to charge you to follow the examples of Bill Gates of Microsoft, Steve Jobs of Apple, Larry Page of Google, Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook, just to mention a few. The future is indeed bright. Once again, you're welcome.
Please, can we put our hands together for the Vice Chancellor? The Vice Chancellor is a professor of computer science, so you can see he's very much at home with the topic for the day. I want to, on your behalf at this juncture, recognize the presence of the Mandate Secretary and the Pioneer Registrar of Covenant University here present, Pastor Yemi Nathaniel. You're welcome, sir. Permit me to now invite the acting HOD CIS to please come and read the citation of the speaker for today, Dr. Ariyo Adebi.
Chancellor, sir, the Vice Chancellor, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, the Registrar, permit me to stand on existing established protocol. I have a singular honor and privilege to read the citation of Professor Sanjay Misra, the lecturer of today. I want to humbly request Professor Misra to stand and remain standing as I read his citation. Professor Sanjay Misra was born in Pataga, India on 38 October in 1971. He completed his high school and higher secondary education in 1985 and 1987, respectively. He obtained a BSc degree in physics through chemistry in 1990 at the age of 19 years, an MSc degree in solid state electronics in 1992 from RML Harvard University of Faizabad, India. He was awarded a Ph.D. applied physics in 1997 by Allahabad University, India. Later, in 2005, Professor Misra obtained another master degree, M.Tech in software engineering from Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology, Allahabad, India. He has also submitted his second Ph.D. thesis in software engineering in University of Alcala, the NRX Madrid, Spain. Professor Misra started his career as lecturer in applied physics at KA Postgraduate College, Allahabad in 1995, and then moved to Dr. K.N. Modi Institute of Engineering and Technology, Mudinagar, India in 1997. United College of Engineering and Research, affiliated with UPTU and Pavanka University, Jaunpur, India in 1999, where he was promoted to reader in 2004. He joined Sobhrati Institute of Technology and Engineering, Lucknow, India in 2005 as associate professor and transferred to Atilim University, Ankara, Turkey in February 2006. He worked there for 4 years and published several articles in the field of software engineering. As a result of outstanding scholarship, he was offered appointment as full professor by two universities. In January 2010, he joined the services of Federal University of Technology, FUT, Minna, Nigeria, as a professor of computer software engineering. Professor Misra served as the founding head, Department of Computer Engineering, FUT, Minna, from February 2010 to September 2011. He also chaired the Cybersecurity Department, School of Information and Communication Technology of the same university from October 2011 to September 2012. In October 2012, Professor Misra joined Covenant University as a professor of computer engineering and is currently in the Department of Computer and Information Sciences at Covenant University. Professor Misra has 21 years of experience in academic administration, researches in various universities in Asia, Europe, and Africa. He has served as acting dean, deputy dean, head of department, coordinator, examination controller, and chairman of important committee in various universities and institutions. He is a visiting professor at the University of Alcalá, Spain, Pontificia Universidad Católica, UCV, Chile, and also UNCEN, Tandy, Argentina, and Atilim University, Turkey. He has traveled to more than 30 countries, Australia, USA, Canada, Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Japan, Korea, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, China, Singapore, Fiji, Nepal, North Cyprus, Israel, South Africa, Tunisia, Ireland, UK, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Austria, Turkey, and several more for various academic endeavors as visiting professor and keynote speaker. His current research covers software quality, software process improvement, software project management, object-oriented technologies, XML, SOA, web services, cognitive informatics, artificial intelligence, neural network, health informatics, e-learning, cloud computing, and cybersecurity. Professor Misra coordinates and collaborates with several research groups in several universities and industry in Nigeria, Spain, Argentina, Turkey, Singapore, Chile, Brazil, Mexico, Norway, France, South Africa, Malaysia, Vietnam, and India. He has authored and co-authored 170 articles. You can give a round of applause for that. With colleagues from 20 countries, majority of which are in IS, High Web of Sciences. 6 of these publications are in Science Citation Index, and he has received many awards for outstanding publications. Recently, Institute of Engineering and Technology, United Kingdom, awarded him 2014 IET Software Premium Award for the best paper published in the last 2 years. The Chancellor, sir, this outstanding academic has delivered 22 preliminary and keynote addresses in renowned IEEE Springer Elsevier sponsor conferences and 33 invited lectures in workshops, seminars, and various universities and institutions in over 30 countries. He is the editor-in-chief of book series on advances in IT personnel and project management, editor of 20 Springer published lectures in computer science, and 5 IEEE conferences proceeding. He was the general chairman of the 6th IEEE International Conference on Adaptive Science and Technology, ICAS 2014, founding chairman of 3 annual international symposia and workshops since 2008, namely International Symposium on Software Engineering Process and Application, published by Springer in Lecture Notes in Computer Science. International Workshop on Tools and Techniques in Software Development Process, published by IEEE in CPS, and International Symposium on Software Quality, published by Springer in Lecture Notes in Computer Science. Presently, he is the chief editor of International Journal of Physical Sciences, founding editor-in-chief of Covenant University Journal of Informatics and Communication Technology, and International Journal of Computer Science and Software Technology. He is serving as editor, associate editor, and editorial board member of more than 20 international journals. He is a reviewer for 18 international journals. Professor Misra has taught about 26 undergraduate and postgraduate courses in software engineering, computer sciences, and electronics at different times. He has completed the supervision of 8 masters and 3 PhD theses, while other postgraduate supervision is ongoing. He has examined several PhD theses from various universities across the world. Professor Misra is married to Ms. Sueta Misra, an extremely caring and dedicated wife, and are blessed with 2 beautiful daughters, 1 smart son, namely Anaya Misra, student of computer engineering in the Middle East Technical University, North Cyprus campus, ranked 85 by Times Higher Education, Abaya Misra SS3, and Ekansi Misra JSS1. He is blessed with wonderful parents, Mr. O.P. Misra, 65 years old, and Mrs. Asha Misra, 61 years old. Also, who
team of this university led by our Bill GC. And the management team of this university led by our MBVC Professor C.K. Ayo for allowing me to deliver this public lecture today. Thank you very much. Before starting this lecture, in fact, which is on the software development process, in the environment of the global software development, I just want to start with some of the background. In fact, it was the 1st January 2010 when we arrived to this continent in Abuja, Nigeria. And I joined to the FUT MENA. My responsibility was to chair to the computer engineering department as well as to establish a school of ICT in FUT MENA. Within a very short period of time, I observed a lot of things regarding to the ICT. And basically in the software development process and software development in the Nigeria. Several questions regarding establishment of the ICT and software industry in the Nigeria A lot of questions start pinching me. There are several positive things which I observed in this country. In fact, before coming to this country, I had no any idea, because I learned about this country what I am listening from outside, especially from the media and here and there. Just I want to share, because this is the background of this lecture. I observed the first thing, that not only the English as the official language in Nigeria, but also Nigeria is the same time zone with the UK and Europe. It was a very, very strong point for the, especially global software development. The second thing which I observed very much, based on my work experience in the three continents, Asia, Europe, and Africa, I don't have any hesitation to say it very proudly, that the Nigerians are the most hardworking guys in the world. They are the most hardworking guys in the world. They wake up early in the morning and can work up to the late night, even without taking a glass of water. And you cannot see even any need. You can always see them as a very, very fresh up to the late night. This is only the beauty of this country. The third thing is, they are very smart and intelligent. There is no any doubt about this one. I'm giving you some example, don't take it otherwise. They are very smart, very intelligent. They can do any work, especially develop any type of software. For example, one of my staff in the FUT, he developed a software which was capable to break the firewall of a renowned internet service provider, through which you can use the unlimited internet access without paying a single naira. It was a truth. You have just to pay 1,000 naira to him. He will give you a software, you can install it, use the unlimited internet. This is one example. How much strong password you keep for your email account, you are not secure. We are able to break it. Having all such qualities, it is hard to understand that why approximately after 25 years of the software industry, we are not in even top 50 countries for the software development. When around 1990s, US start looking after other countries for their software development, because it was extremely expensive in the US, they find India, mainly due to the three reasons. The first one is the English as a common language, second one is the cheap labor, and the third one is the quality education system. But all these three things were also available more or less in Nigeria. Then why Nigeria is neglected till date? If we talk about the corruption in the system, it is everywhere. Only the percentage is different. You cannot find a single country, very few, where the corruption is not there. All these issues motivate me to identify the crisis for the lack of global software development in this country. This motivate me to work to find out why there is a crisis for the global software development, even at the good platform of the software engineering, software development. So, if you go to the first slide, the whole lecture is going to be divided by the introduction, outsourcing and offshoring softwares, problem definition and research questions, research methodology, result, and the way forward to the Nigeria. Globalization has transformed the information technology industry from its roots. Software development offshoring is one of the results of the phenomena that has gained the momentum in the last several years. The growth of software development offshoring as a strategic option has transformed what has traditionally an internal firm activity to one driven by the external vendors, in which application development services are totally or partially outsourced. Driven by continuous advance in the information technology, the trends towards offshore software outsourcing has been growing steadily since the 1990s, and now offshore software outsourcing has become an attractive strategy for companies that want to reduce the cost, concentrate on the core competence, access to the specialized resources, and increase the overall competitive advantage. In early 1990s, offshoring of the software works to development centers in low wages countries pertained to large Western companies such as IBM and SAP, who systematically attempted to take advantage of the wage differences and resources of global market. The global software development involves the development of the software through interaction of the people, organization, and technology across nations with different backgrounds, languages, and working styles. This interaction brings diversity and intrinsic difficulty to an already complex process. GSD has attracted attention from both academics and the industry due to the complexity and challenges related to its natures. In 1990s, saw the emergence of the three I's, Ireland, India, and Israel, as the principal location for the significant globally distributed software development. Eastern Europe, Latin America, and the Far East have been pointed out as a feasible and successful GSD location. In spite of the literature devoted to the GSD, Africa, apart from the South Africa and North Africa, plays a discrete role in the phenomena. The aim of this lecture is to identify the opportunities and challenges of the sub-Saharan Africa in general and Nigeria in particular as a GSD designation. The inherent analysis is performed from the two points of view, the outsourcer placed in the developed world and the African perspective. Given the importance of the MIND countries, it is very, very important point, Mexico, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Turkey. In today's economy and given the perspective of their economics in the forecast, this lecture is valuable for the IT professionals and the manager alike. It is important for Nigeria as a perspective of growth can make this economy double in 6 or 7 years. Furthermore, this lecture provides a better understanding of the areas of the development in all sectors, including information technology, both from customer and provider perspective. So let us start from the outsourcing and offsourcing software. What are the challenges? Different conception on the nature of the software development process. Disparities in the team members, strategies, behavior, and assumptions about the work at hand and how to work with the others. Higher conflicts and the stress. Intellectual property issues. Issues in the communication, coordination, and control. Knowledge transfer issues, lack of quality, lack of trust, less efficiency, political stability, including the aspects like corruptions, terrorism, threats, and the uncertainty relating to the trade and investment, socio-cultural distance. What are the opportunity for the outsourcing and offshoring softwares? Access to new pool of the multi-skilled workforce, higher creativity due to the mix of the cultural backgrounds, higher efficiency and the productivity, lower personal cost, shorter time to market cycle, and strategic regional presence and the knowledge of the local needs. We are taking a case study of the sub-Saharan Africa. Software development outsourcing is seen as an economic development tool for transition economics, and Africa has been part of the phenomena. In the nutshell, according to Abbott, South Africa remains a dominant player in this industry in the African continent, while the North African countries are struggling to retain their former popularity due to the business uncertainty arising from recent political upheaval in the region. Sub-Saharan Africa refers to all countries in the Africa except the 5 countries of the North Africa, which are more socio-economically similar to the Middle East, and the Republic of the South Africa, which, although a part of the Sub-Saharan Africa, is a very different economically from the rest of Sub-Saharan Africa. Most of the works has been reported interaction in the GSD environment with the South Africa, among other reasons, is because this country is placed in the same time zone as EU nations. According to the Global Outsourcing Report, the Rainbow Nations has among the 20 best countries marked as the global opportunity for the IT offshore investment and is predicted to rise to the 15th place by 2015. The second big set of the opportunity comes from the POC countries, mainly Morocco, Tunisia, and to lesser extent Mauritius and Senegal. The common language, similar time zone, and cultural compatibility makes Morocco as a attractive destination for the French organizations. According to the same month, French companies, for the instance, now rely on the employees in Senegal and Morocco for help with the different outsourcing project. In a sense, it can be said that that is formed the nearshoring for those companies. Carmel and Abbott have cited Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, and Egypt, nearshore nation in the West Europe scope. However, in the case of Morocco, which may be the best place according to this Bourneau et al., it is necessary to carry out long-term development policies together with short-term internal demand incentives to a small and medium firms for the ICT adoption, promotion of the country image to compete to the market. Mauritius is another good example of outsourcing-oriented country in a southern African region. The small island nation of the Mauritius, located in the Indian Ocean approximately 1,200 miles off the coast of Africa, has recognized information and communication technologies as the key to its long-term development. This country is making a concerted effort to the progress in the software development field, and a result of this is attracting GSG projects. Apart from the South Africa, some sub-Saharan Africa continental countries are building their future economic on the IT. For instance, Rwanda is investing in infrastructure. Time will tell if the Rwanda will be able to compete the GSG market. Ghana is included in the global outsourcing report. This work underlines the Ghana low cost of living, stable democratic government, and the literate English-speaking population make it well suited as an outsourcing location. Nigeria and Ghana are the good example of the countries attractive for offshoring outsourcing but not ready. These locations have relatively cheap workforce and a fair number of trained IT professionals and are also attractive due to their time zone bracket with the potential client countries. Nigeria perhaps to be one of the sub-Saharan African countries that is feasible outsourcing option for the European country for a number of regions. The official language is English. The time zone is almost the same as Europe, and most importantly, it is the most populated country in Africa. The country is rich in terms of its resources and has a huge human capital potential. Nigeria higher education system currently have 127 approved universities, 41 federal universities, 25 state universities, and 61 private universities, and over 100 other tertiary institutions, College of Education, Polytechnic, etc. While these factors should be attractive points for outsourcing, but in reality, Nigeria is not part of the outsourcing phenomena, taking into account that this country is not among the top 50 countries in 80 Kenna Global Service Location Index 2014, while, for instance, Ghana is in 29th. If you see this graph, I don't know that if you can read it. In the first 24, except the Egypt, there is no any other country. Egypt is also in the 10th position. In the last 4 years, it has lost the fourth position because it was in 2011, it was on the fourth rank. Now it is in 2014, it is in the 10th rank. In up to the 24, except Egypt, no any African country is there. And if you go to the next slide, this is from 26 to the 50, you can find that Tunisia, Ghana, Morocco, Mauritius, Senegal, South Africa, are the countries which is in the Africa. They are up to the 50, even though the Ghana is also on the 29th. It was in 2011, it was in 27th position. In 2014, it is in 29th position. You can see that the top 50 countries, which is taken as for the good place for the outsourcing. The observation promotes the following research questions. Why is Nigeria is not considered a valid option for the GSD projects? The question led to the design of short interview guide consisting of 5 generic open questions about the motivators and challenges in the GSD projects in Nigeria. Though the open-ended questions, the researchers obtained broad and valuable information from European and African practitioners about the region behind this regarded of sub-Saharan Africa as an outsourcing destination. The research methodology, the overall process consisted of the 2 studies conducted in parallel. The first took place in Africa and the second was conducted in Europe. The final aim was to construct the conclusion of both studies, bringing a bilateral perspective to the research questions. Both studies were performed through a semi-structured interview with a sample of professionals. The semi-structured interview were developed to systematically explore views on all research questions and sub-questions. The interview guide consisted of the series of open questions to collect the qualitative data. The authors designed the scripts carefully to ensure that there was no bias in the formulation and in the identification of risk, challenges, and opportunities. The semi-structured interview sought to collect the qualitative data about the following factors. These factors are very important. Main motivators to conduct GSD project in Nigeria. Main disadvantage or preventing factors to contract GSD project in Nigeria. Main challenges and risks to contract GSD project in Nigeria. Main competitive advantages of the Nigeria with respect to the GSD. Social jobs, cultural characteristics that can influence to contract GSD. The analysis of the interview was carried out using a commercial software of the qualitative data analysis. The tool is used to organize, classify, and analyze the information, but also to explore the review trends in the both studies. Besides, it permit to establish the connection among the content as well as to extract conclusion from data. First study, from the African perspective, the research selected and focused on two Nigerian-based companies as a sample for the prospective study. Both have branches in different states in Nigeria. Interviews were conducted with several stakeholders. Interview were face-to-face with one-to-one meeting where the questions were asked by the authors to get information from the stakeholders. Subjects were selected from those who answered positively to a personal invitation sent by the authors. The interviews were selected based on their responsibility in gathering the requirements from clients who were engaged in interviewing users and who were observing users' activities and gathering the documents to construct the requirement for development of the system. The main method for collecting the data was by tap in the depth interview. Open-ended questions were used and members of the team had freedom to describe at length their experience and problems. The sample consisted of the 25 subjects with an average age of the 34.8 and the average working experience of 8.2 years. 20% of the respondents held a professional certificate while 40% had the bachelor's, 20% have MBA and master degree. All respondents had the experience in outsourced project in Nigeria of at least one project. 60% had experience in more than 10 projects, and 40% had experience in one of 10 projects. The results from the African perspective. Main motivators to contact the GSD project in the Nigeria from African perspective. Language is 88%, time zone is 50%, human capital increases of the young students trained in the IT discipline 76%, and cost reduction is 60%. Disadvantage to contact GSD project in Nigeria, lack of confidence in the administrative and the bureaucratic systems, low overall technology development, lack of IT project management experience. Main challenge, risk to contact the GSD, lack of knowledge on the culture and customs. Main competitive advantage of Nigeria with respect to the GSD, political stability in recent years, a stronger economy, increase in young people trained in the IT disciplines, young population, positive predictions about the economic future of the country. Forecasts estimate that the Nigeria economy could stay ahead of South Africa in next 15 years. Commitment to the technological development by the government and intellectual property right and information security. Social job and cultural characteristics that can influence to contract GSD. Administrative and social corruption. Poor image of the country due to the fraud, violence or the terrorism. Now the second is from the European perspective, the same set of the questions, same set of the study. A group of software practitioners and managers were interviewed using a semi-structured interview. All subjects were professionals with the experience in the GSD and in performing projects in sub-Saharan Africa and an average of 1.6 years of experience in Africa. The sample consisted of 3 women and 10 men with an average age of the 42.3 and an average working experience of 18.6 years. The subjects were selected from those who answered positively to a personal invitation sent by the authors among Spinard and the French IT companies. The semi-structured interview were assisted by at least one researcher. The average interview lasted approximately 84 minutes and was performed either in the respondents' workplace or the research centers. The room guaranteed that no one at work could overhear the responses. Each interview was tape recorded using the speaker phone. During the interview, the authors took the extensive notes which were compared to the interview recording in order to avoid mistakes during the transcriptions. So what are the results? Main motivation to contact GSD in Nigeria from the European perspective. This is the cost cutting. It is 100%. Language is 92%. Time zone proximity 85%. Human capital availability is 62%. What are the disadvantages from the European perspective? Weak software industry. Need to organize the development teams directly due to the scarcity of the local suppliers. Cost of the management and the organization procedures mentioned above. Cost of the expedition, requirement of the local mediators, etc. Lack or the concern about the legislative local taxes and the businesses, which is 78%. Poor transparency of the codes, high taxes, high risk of the capital losses. The main challenges, risk to contact the GSD project in Nigeria. This is identify appropriate contacts and the partners. These are the very big challenges. Adaptability and the flexibility in the contract and the negotiations. Shortage of the companies providing software services, 85%. Investment in the training and the human resource development, this is 85%. Traditional social and political instability, this is 38%. What are the, again, these challenges? Differences in the professional practices, this is 69%. Distance in the conception of hierarchy, competitiveness, team, time, and norms. Cultural distance that lead to a team management issues in the terms of 85% that include the team management and leadership. Competitive advantage of Nigeria, that is the alternative to an Asia. Willingness to the learn and adopt the technology. Economy development, employability and youth. You know that the majority of the software development companies, they are going to the India and other Vietnam, even the Bangladesh has entered into the last series. So you know that the China has captured the hardware, India has captured the software industry, and remaining other Asian countries, they are capturing for the software industry. So this Nigeria-like country here, they can be alternative to the Asia. Also, the social jobs and cultural characteristics that can influence to the contract the GSD, corruption, dash culture, that is 100%. Socially able, friendable, and warm people, this is 100%. Fraud or the extortion, 78%. Lack of the work discipline, 54%. Low initiative, 38%. Violences or the terrorism, this is 31%. Now we are going to compare both from the African side and the European side, what they are saying. What are the main motivators to contact the GSD in Nigeria? If you see this graph, the cost, human capital, time zone, and language, the both from European side and African side, they are more or less, they are agreeable that they can reduce the cost. If you see that from European side, it is higher, and from the African side, it is lower. Similarly, the human capital, more or less, they are equal. What are the main disadvantages to contract the GSD in the Nigeria? If you see that, weak experience and industry, it is higher from the European side, lower from the African side. You can see the tech development, there is nothing from the European side, but it is from the African side. It may be due to the, because European may not know about the technological development here. Do the business, it is for the same, almost same for the lack of the companies, it is also from the European side. Appropriate partners, it is also from the European side. Yes, cultural distance, they both are agreeable. What are the main competitive advantages of the Nigeria? If you see that employability, alternative to the Asia, this is also from both from the European side. This for the intellectual property right, it is only from the African side. Tech competent, this is you can see from that, this is a forecast. Young population, people in IT, economy, and the stability. If you observe that this graph, stability it is given by the African side, it is high, but It is just against to the European what they are saying in the previous slide, that is the instability is very high in the Nigerian context if you compare with the last two slides. Social jobs and the cultural characteristics in the Nigerian that influence the GSD, low initiatives, work disciplines and the worn people. It is some of the positive factors from the European side, violence, fraud and corruptions from both sides they have mentioned. The way forward for the Nigeria. In order for Nigeria to benefit from the outsourcing revolution, there is a need for a repositioning both at the national level and at the corporate level. As a nation, concentrated efforts must be made in the carrying out our laid out policies, one of which is giving the same level of priority on the power, oil and gas to the ICT development. At present, effort is being made to establish the necessary infrastructure to facilitate access to the internet. They should also lead to the better internet services at affordable prices for the software outsourcing provider. Also in the area of the knowledge, we must move from just emphasizing the need of increased money spent on education, as this will not necessarily improve our situation as observed in a recent study, to ensuring that right from the kindergarten, students develop basic skills required in the 21st century workplace, among which are the software development skills. Sound knowledge acquisition is a major milestone that has been achieved in countries like India and Southeast Asia that is presently yielding a lot of dividends. Repositioning at the national level. Furthermore, the establishment of the outsourcing services friendly zone in Nigeria, similar to the Bangalore model in India, can be pursued. This zone can be established in a place like Ozobe, being a town where most of the Nigeria electricity is generated and relatively stable in comparison to other parts of the country. Among other things, it will be adequately equipped and made conductive for the attracting foreign outsourcing services. The proposed plan is to set up a technological park in the Bauchi state is a welcome idea that, if fully implemented and properly managed, will set the nation on the upward trajectory technologically. In addition, there is a need to improve the nation's global image by supporting initiatives like those of Adrigentic, who proposed the set up of a fabrication laboratory in Yaba, Lagos. The lab is yet to materialize due to the insufficient fund. If such an idea gets funded, it has prospects of attracting outsourcing services that can turn the nation into a technological hub and possibly improving our global image positively. Foreign companies prospecting for an offshore outsource service providers always have a checklist of what to look out for. Some of these include the business profile of the outsource service provider, which is expected to be made available on the web. Some of the other details mostly sought are the expertise possessed by the OSP, the financial strength of the OSP, the evidences of the core competence of the OSP in the particular project area, which should exist in the form of project case, study reports, company technical reports and the research papers, which should exist online on the OSP website. As a result, a number of things are essential as minimum standard for prospective OSP. Some of these, a web presence. Every prospective OSP needs to have a proactive presence on the internet with a rich, dynamic and highly interactive website. Track record of ethics and integrity. Every prospective OSP must be ready to do business in a professional manner, not in a Nigerian way, with a display of high degree of moral ethics in the business dealing. Foreign companies tend to strict on keeping to contractual schedule and the deadlines, and default may most likely be considered as a contractual violations. Development of the core competence. OSP needs to develop special skills and core competence and the certification in a way that make them fit to compete favorable and what obtain in the developed countries, as this is only way to attract foreign mentors. The OSP should also strive to attain the international technical certification such as SCI, CMM, level 3, 4, 5. Conclusion. This lecture presented is a qualitative exploratory study that analyzes the region for the considering an African country like Nigeria as a sourcing country for the GSD projects. In general, it can be deducted from the analysis is that the factors that affect the sourcing decision in Nigeria and other African regions are significant enough to reduce the probability of competing with Asian countries. However, there are many positive factors to be optimistic about the future of the country like Nigeria. Its relative political stability, economic strength achieved in recent years, and increased development of its workforce make Nigeria a nation to watch in a medium and long term. One interesting finding of this study is European do not have sufficient knowledge and understanding of the peculiarities of the Africans, and this is even so among those who have professional experience in Africa. Literature shows that, in general, African societies are quite hierarchical, collectivistic, and short-term oriented, and this cultural background leads to the need for a proper and tailored personal management approach. Also, cross-cultural understanding will be enhanced by a cultural dimension analysis, e.g. the power distance, uncertainty, avoidance, muscularity, and the individualism that would help us better understand the differences between Africans and Europeans. Furthermore, in a practical sense, the study can be used to promote the effect of motivating factors and mitigate the effect of the risk factor in GSD prospect in the sub-Saharan Africa. What we can do it? Being a leading university in this continent, we can also help to improve the level of GSD in Nigeria. A software bar can be established, like several other universities in the developed and developing countries. A very simple example is the Middle East Health Care University, is the 85 rank university by the has more than 400 companies in the campus in Ankara. Also, there is a need to do from the eagles of the CU. The eagles of the CU are the most smart and intelligent guys in this continent. They have broken records in many areas. It is also your responsibility to come forward and change the image of this beautiful country by establishing nice environment for the global software development. There are several ways to do it. I know that there are several 400 students are sitting here. They are going to join several big companies in the Nigeria. But where we are lacking that, all those multinational companies in Nigeria, they are coming, they are establishing, but they are only marketing their project. They are only marketing their products. They are not interested in anything in developing in Nigeria. So once you are going to join there, you can also help.
The Vice Chancellor, I like to be granted the indulgence of standing on the already established protocols. I again count it a privilege tonight, even though it was one that I to be. But some of us who probably are in a good knowledge of the ongoing agenda in the church could understand why he could not be here. Mr. Vice Chancellor, again, I'd like to let you know the Chancellor's commitment and desire to be here, and he has asked me to bring his goodwill message and to say thank you again for the experience of tonight. Without any doubt, Professor Misra has done something very great tonight, maybe because of my little interest in the topic that he has presented. Without any doubt, his academic pedigree, which is quite deep, has been reflected in the robust presentation that we have witnessed tonight. It was Bill Gates that once said that software is a combination between artistry and engineering. And I'd like to say that tonight, listening to Professor Mr. Sanjay, I could see such a combination in tonight's presentation. Please, I'd like us to give a clap. The global software development challenges as presented here and the very erudite analysis that had been done, particularly the cross-cultural analysis, because from the time that I had the privilege of having a copy of this paper, I desired to really know exactly where it is, because as a nation, and his focus is on Nigeria and the African continent, we kept coming here at this very rich intellectual culture of having a public presentation or public lecture to look at the issues that affect us as a people. And again, to see from the understanding of persons who had invested quality time in trying to find out where the gaps are and to see how we can move forward from there. And in one of his recommendations, Professor Misra specifically said we should give emphasis, you know, to ICT the same way or in the same order that we give to the oil sector and the power sector. And if anybody knows what the global software development had come to be for some of the nations, even the three I's that he mentioned, Ireland, Israel, and India, you know, how the import of their inroad or the great things that they did in that area had greatly elevated the nation. Today, those three nations remain in spite of the fact that there had been a move and several other nations had come on board, but you can still see the great foundation that it meant in several other areas. We need truly to continue to concentrate our effort in executing relevant policies, particularly the weak infrastructure base. This university, Covenant University, from the examples and the things that we have been able to do, we can see that there are quite a lot of things that we can also pick from here. But perhaps, as a concluding remark, the Chancellor has always spoken about the unfortunate experience of having unequal development by men and nations who ordinarily have equal destinies. You can see the various highlights from the cross-cultural analysis that Professor Misra did in terms of looking at those issues, the motivating factors, the mitigating factors, the disadvantages, and the social factors. And we come to see that it is quite obvious that if we would stand up from here, as we should do with every public lecture, to develop an action plan that will help us to cover the gaps and see to it that our potentials are realized, rather than coming here to just lament and forget what we see in the mirror of the intellectual knowledge that we have gained. Again, therefore, on behalf of the Chancellor, I'd like to appeal to the Vice Chancellor and the entire management that we must not let the rich culture and the investment that came into this public lecture go without us taking full advantage of them. This is something, one of the treasures that's available and we have potentials to develop, but somehow we end it up there. We never walk the talk. But Covenant University, as you are very much aware, has come as an example of really walking the talk. And when you look at the history of the university and the exploit of the university, it is obvious that this is one thing again that we'll pick up from here and make sure Nigeria gets to where it's supposed to get to. And in the name of Jesus Christ, that is going to be in a very short while. I know the lecturer mentioned that there is a need to make sure that the Nigerian potentials, you know, the totality of the factors does not suggest that we are on where we are supposed to be. He said, but that in the medium term and in the long term, we are a nation to watch. It is my desire and that of the proprietors of this university that the medium term, we will cut it short. It will become a short term in the name of Jesus Christ. And with every one of us rising up to it, it shall be done. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you, sir. That had been the Mandate Secretary of the Living Faith Church Worldwide and the Pioneer Registrar of Covenant University. Please, we may be seated. We'd like to recognize some persons that have come from the external community to be part of this public lecture. in no particular order, but we'd like to start from the family of the lecturer for today. As it has been mentioned, the wife of our lecturer is here present. Can we recognize Mrs. Sweta Misra? And the lovely two daughters and the son that are here present. Please, can you rise for recognition? You're welcome. Please, you may be seated. We also have in no particular order the Director of Academic Planning, Bells University, Dr. Adioye. But here is in his capacity as the rep of the Nigerian Society of Engineers. You're welcome, sir. We also have a director in the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, here representing the permanent secretary of that ministry, Dr. John Olanrewaju Oni. You're welcome, sir. We also have Mr. Oladokun Oye here present. We have the manager, Total Nigeria PLC, Mrs. Abiodun Duke, here present. Mr. Cornelius Abba is here, Elder Fred Olasheinde. We have a legal practitioner here present, Mr. Benjamin, you are welcome. We have from CPN, the computer professionals, Mr. Idowu, here present. You're welcome, sir. We also have the representative of the Vice Chancellor, Bells University of Technology, Dr. Akimbor. You're welcome. We have several persons all the way from the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, Mr. Divine, Mr. Samuel, Mr. Adebayo. You're all welcome. We also have Mrs. Adetunji, also from that Federal Ministry of Science and Technology. And here present as well, we have Mr. Oladokun Oye, the Regional Operation Director, Airtel. You are welcome, sir. We also have here a geophysicist from Dombey Petroleum International, Mr. Oladayo. You're welcome. Mr. Amor, from Managing Director of Corporate Mine Associates. You're welcome. From that same venture, we have Mr. Michael. You are welcome. And Mr. Adeinka. The men of the praise are also very much around here. We have Dayo from Vanguard, Femi Ige from News Agency of Nigeria, Alausa from National Mirror. We have Folashade Adebayo from Punch. We have Taiwo from Leadership. We have Yusuf from New Telegraph. We have Onyenirong Akpata from Daily Independent. We have Adeyemi from The Guardian, and then Esther Bakare from Newswatch. We'd like to welcome all of us. At this point, we'll recognize two of our guests to please come and give their impressions about this lecture, starting from the director from the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, here representing the permanent secretary of that ministry, Dr. John Olanrewaju Oni. And then lastly, we'll have Mr. Oladokun Oye, the regional director of Airtel. Please, can we start from our rep of the permanent secretary, Federal Minister of Science and Technology, just your impressions in a short moment. You're welcome, sir.
Good afternoon, the Chancellor, the Vice Chancellor, and on this note, I will seize this opportunity to stand on the existing protocol. The goodwill message of the Permanent Secretary of the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, in the person of Mrs. Winifred Oyo Ita, FCA, who is unavoidably absent due to the exigency of duty, as we all know that the change mantra, which is already going on around the country, is really taking all the permanent secretaries on their toes. So he said I should sincerely apologize for his unavoidably absence. And he has directed me to give this goodwill message. It is a great pleasure and indeed an honor to be invited to one of the foremost private universities in Nigeria, the Covenant University, OTA, especially on the occasion of the 43rd public lecture of this great institution of higher learning that has taken upon itself the responsibility of redefining qualitative education, bearing in mind the role of moral upbringing and a medium of building a Nigerian society with special attention on the promotion of science and technology in spite of its challenges. As a nation, the need to embrace the promotion of science and technology-based inventions and innovations in the various institutions of higher learning is very pertinent. And if we must be relevant among the committee of nations that has the capacity to cope with the increasing changes in this time and age of a fast-moving world as a result of the development and application of information and communication technology, software packages used in solving various human challenges and problems, thereby making planet Earth a global village. On the part of the government, the new National Science and Technology and Innovation, that is STI policy, has its core as a mission that will evolutionize a Nigerian that harness, develop, and utilize its STI to build a large, strong, diversified, sustained, and competitive economy that guarantee a high standard of living and quality of life to its citizens. Specifically, the new STI policy is the success of the new economic transformation blueprint will especially require the institution of science and technology thinking as a way of seeing and doing business at all strata of the society, from the household and small businesses level to all tiers of government. In our collective interest as a people and a nation to therefore pursue the implementation of this policy, which was designed to drive the economy evolutionary transformation and deliver its objectives as an integral part of the new vision of 2020. The Federal Ministries of Science and Technology and Information and Communication Technology has been doing its best through its various relevant agencies, such as Nigerian Air Space Management Agency, NASDA, and Nigerian Information Technology Development Agency, NITDA, by providing an enabling environment for the development of science and technology and ICT as their core mandate. And the National Board for Technology Incubation, which is NBTI, with the mandate of commercializing any invention so as to bring the commercializable inventions to the public domain as public goods and services. The launching of SAT-1 and SAT-2 into the Nigerian airspace is a great landmark as well as a platform for our great nation, Nigeria, to explore every opportunity the facility has provided in the interest of our citizens, such as such applications which include geographical placement system, GPS, telecommunication, metrology, security, and remote monitoring, and so on and so forth. The role of software packages in the day-to-day running of our national life cannot be overestimated, as it is fondly used in virtually all various sectors of the Nigerian economy, such as the banking, the public sector, the agriculture, the health, aviation sector, and many more. Professionals which have found their task less burdensome through the use of professional software packages, in spite of its acclaimed cause of unemployment in recent times. Kindly permit me to seize this opportunity to challenge all the stakeholders in the educational sector to channel all their efforts and resources towards encouraging our students to develop their interest in science and technology-based studies, starting from the elementary schools to higher institutions of learning, such as this. The provision of necessary facilities that can aid learning should also be made available, and no nation can be considered to be developed except with its development in science and technology. It will be delightsome if some emphasis is laid on the entrepreneurial activities that abound in the development of software packages, as well as information and communication technology, ICT, in line with today's public lecture, Global Software Development, challenges and opportunities in Nigeria. However, you are assured of this present administration's commitment to the provision of enabling environment for educational development, especially in its policies for a vibrant nation endowed with highly trained citizens capable of meeting its human capital requirement at any point in time. Before I round off my goodwill message, I wish to commend the Board of Regents of this great institution for their visionary leadership role in the attainment of Covenant University's mandate and for various developmental projects that is evident in this great institution of higher learning. And I will not fail to sincerely appreciate the management and staff of this institution, while special appreciation goes to the host community for their unusual support at all times for this university. As we deliberate on this topic, global software development, challenges and opportunities in Nigeria, I wish Covenant University utter a happy deliberation. Before I say God bless Covenant University or God bless Nigeria, I happen to be the director for the technology incubation in Ogun State and a director of the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology. And Ogun State is the first state that is housing a 3 technology incubation centers in Nigeria with all facilities available. And not only that, we are at the verge of starting or kickstarting a science and a technology park. And I'm glad to announce on this podium today that one of the eagles of this university is undergoing a technology incubation program of 3 years with Technology Incubation Center in Abeokuta. And the product has gone so wide that it is internationally competitive. And the person is here, and his name is Oniide Divine, and his products have been registered with NAFDAC, have been satisfied with Standard Organization of Nigeria, and his product is highly competitive with other products that is imported. On this note, that is why I take the advantage to bring him to this place, sir. And the guy is really doing well. And so I'm happy to be here, even to represent the Permanent Secretary, that this university is churning out the eagles of tomorrow. And I want to say, maybe because I sat under the administration of Papa for 2 years, between 1996 and 1998, at Rajoba, and the Technology Incubation Center and Technology Park in Nigeria has taken its toll from Ogun State. And from Ogun State, we have established another 8 incubation centers in another state in Nigeria. And this man that is standing here is the only one that enthroned the Director General of the current National Technology Incubation in Abuja. And that is why the Permanent Secretary is delighted that I should be the one to represent him here. Thank you. And God bless Covenant University. God bless Nigeria. So on behalf of our Permanent Secretary, Mrs. Winifred Oyoita, FCA, Permanent Secretary, Federal Minister of Science and Technology, Nigeria, Abuja, thank you and God bless you.
What a validation for what God has been doing in Covenant University. That had been Dr. John Oni, representing the Permanent Secretary for the Ministry of Science and Technology. We'd like to recognize and welcome now Mr. Oladokun Oye, the Regional Operation Director, ATEL, to please do the needful in a very short while. Thank you.
The Chancellor of Covenant University and the VC, standing on existing protocols. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't have a scripted address, but from my observation, Professor Misra's work is well researched, full of data, and like you expect, very intellectual. I'm on the side of Airtel. We have commenced some of the things that is being discussed. For example, our IT department has been outsourced, fully outsourced to a company. I don't want to advertise the company, but we have several other things by doing in Airtel that is being outsourced. So outsourcing is now the global way, and Airtel is fully aligned to that. As the third largest telecoms company in the world, talking about subscriber base, we at Airtel, I'm giving a goodwill message on behalf of the managing director, CEO of Airtel, Mr. Shegun Ogbusoya, who's unavoidably absent. He had to attend to some other function, and he has asked me to represent him. So on that note, I say good luck to Covenant University. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Outsourcing is the way to go. We'd like to announce that immediately after this, we're going to be having a cocktail just opposite this auditorium, the Center for Learning Resources. So we'd like to invite all our guests, all our invited guests who came from the external community, to please join us at that cocktail. At this point, we'd like to invite the Director of Academic Planning to please come and move a vote of thanks, Dr. Olawande Daramola.
Standing on the existing protocol, I want to, on behalf of the management of Covenant University, and indeed the Department of Computer and Information Sciences, first express our appreciation to the Chancellor, ably represented here today by the Mandate Secretary of the Living Faith Commission, Pastor Yemi Nathaniel. Sir, we appreciate your contribution on this platform. And we can indeed say that what you have given us this afternoon is a worthy representation, and we are proud of that. Thank you so much, sir. Also, I want to appreciate all our friends from the external contests, those that have given words of contribution here, from Airtel, from also the representative of the Permanent Secretary of the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, and all the other eminent dignitaries from the external context that have been part of this event today. We deeply appreciate your presence here, and we pray that as you go back, the presence of the Lord will go with you, and we hope that when next we call, you'll be readily available. Thank you so much. Also, we want to appreciate eminent faculty and staff that have made our time to be here today, and also the men of the press. We appreciate your presence, and we hope that the coverage of this event will be as representative as expected. And we pray that as we go, the blessing of the Lord will also go with you in Jesus' name. And to our students, this event wouldn't have been complete without your presence. We appreciate you deeply for making our time to be here. And we know that the future is great in Jesus' name. So we want to appreciate everyone for being a part of this event, and wish everyone a lovely evening. Thank you so much.
And so as we close, we'd like to invite the chaplain of Covenant University, Pastor Charles, to please come and give us the closing prayer. And after that, we'll take the CU anthem.
Shall we rise up and give him glory and praise? Lift up your voice and magnify his name. Eternal Rock of Ages, we thank you for this eventful lecture. We give you glory and honor. We thank you for your spirit of understanding and wisdom that you released unhindered upon everyone participant. We give you glory and praise. Father, the seed that you have sown through the guest lecturer and the minds of everyone here present, we pray and ask that it will germinate, it will grow, it will bear fruit, it will change the course of knowledge in this nation, and your name alone shall be glorified. Father, we thank you. Lord, as we close tonight, go ahead of us. Everyone that traveled, Lord, will commit their journeys back unto your able hands. They shall arrive back home safely. Your presence will never elude us here. Lord, we thank you. we give you glory and praise. Your spirit will always work with us here. Father, we glorify your name. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Shall we share that goodness and mercy in fellowship one to go? Surely. All the days of our life, we are in the presence of the Lord. Forever. Praise the Lord.
The band, as we have the CU anthem. Thank you. Procession now is going to be in reverse.